in our midst. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for someone such as I? At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. Oh, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
God for the cross. If you stood for the beginning part of the service, you may take your seat for just a few minutes. I just want to highlight in a few words, in a very short exhortation, what this night is all about and the power of praise and how this is worthwhile, how this is beneficial. But I want to, if I forget, thank the band and the team. Our drummer is no longer a guest. I mean, Joel is now sort of one of us, and we're happy to have him. But the band is already sounding good, and the team is sounding wonderful. So I trust that you are being blessed, and it's just going to be a wonderful night. So get ready. This is like if you're watching Game of Thrones or whatever you get excited about, just turn up the music. Turn up the volume, and just when we start the worship time, just worship and just get into the presence of the Lord. But I just want to share a little bit about the power of praise, or praise warfare, however you want to call it. But I just want to tell us a few things as we get into this, because as we are praising God, we are engaging in warfare on a different level. You know, there are two metaphors that describes Jesus' character in the Bible. A lamb that speaks of his willingness, how docile he is, his meekness, and a lion. Jesus' character is portrayed by the lion and the lamb. And the lamb is the assertiveness, the resilience, his resoluteness. And I want you to get this, because Jesus is not just lamb, he is lion. What do I mean? I mean, a lamb went to the cross, but the lion rose from the grave. It was a lion that was turning tables over in the temple, saying, you have turned my father's, this was supposed to be a house of prayer, but you've turned it into a house of thieves, or a den of thieves. That was a lion at work. And if we are going to realize our full potential, we too need to live life balancing the lion and the lamb. In other words, we too need to live life balancing these two aspects of Jesus' character. Because the lamb aspect affects the kind of person that you are, but the lion aspect affects the kind of life you will live. And so the advancement of God's kingdom will always encounter demonic oppression. In other words, what do I mean? The advancement of God's kingdom, raising your children the way God desires, you will always encounter opposition. Having a marriage the way God desires, you will always encounter opposition. Being single and staying holy and pure and committed to the Lord, you will always encounter satanic opposition. Walking in integrity and good character, you will always encounter satanic oppression. Trying to live the way God has desired for you to live, you will always encounter satanic oppression. And that's why these times of worship, that's why the events in the church are meant to help us in our Christian journey. They are meant to help us to know how to be encouraged and to be motivated to live the way that we ought to live. If we are always going to encounter satanic opposition, it means that we need to develop the disposition of a lion. If you're going to overcome opposition in life, you need to know how to roar. What I'm saying is that, because sometimes what happens is, when we experience opposition, we sometimes think it's a sign that we're out of God's will. We sometimes think, well, what did I do wrong? I must have failed. This must be punishment for something. But no, I'm submitting to you that sometimes it's very possible that when you are experiencing opposition, it's a sign that you're actually walking in the steps that God has ordered for you. I want us to think for a minute. We won't make this long, but I'm just talking with you if you would hear me. And I want us to think of the narratives of war in the Bible. And when, especially in the Old Testament, I mean, there's a lot of war. Like, I could understand why somebody would say, my goodness, our God is always in a war. But the narratives of war in the Bible, they're not there because God loves war. They are there to show us that if we are going to possess our godly inheritance, if we are going to get all that God has for us, we must be willing to overcome, or we must be willing to overthrow some opposers and overcome some opposition, because we will not possess what God has for us without a fight. But Pastor, it's a worship and praise night. Why are you talking about this? Bear with me. I'm coming to it. Because if, remember the title, I'm just exhorting you on praise warfare. If you're going to get the kind of marriage that you want, if you're going to get what God has for you, if you're going to raise the kids that you want, if you're going to have financial success the way that you want it, if you're going to have career success the way that you ought to have it, it's going to come with a fight. Do you remember the walls of Jericho? And do you remember when they shouted, the walls fell? But do you know what happened after the walls fell? They had to fight. I hope I'm enlightening you. Because your willingness to face and to overthrow opposition is a demonstration of your belief in God's promises for you. You see, you will not fight for what you don't believe is yours. You will fight for what you are convinced is yours. You see, peace that passes all understanding will not come without a fight. And sometimes it's the fight of keeping your mind clear of negativity. Joy that is unspeakable and full of glory will not come without a fight. You know, when you read the Song of Songs, a Song of Songs marriage will not come without a fight. A Joseph-like influenced business will not come without a fight. So you need a commitment that no matter how long it takes, no matter how strong the devil's stance in my life may be, you need to be determined that you will go after all that God has for you. Why does God allow the fight? Well, God allows the fight because the opposition, the confrontations that we face, they prepare us for the challenges of living in the promise. I want you to understand that, yes, God is taking us somewhere. And God has promises that he's given us, that he's made to us, and they will come to pass. But every promise that God has given to us comes with problems. You'll be blessed with children. They're going to turn teenagers. You'll be blessed with marriage. Well, you're going to have communication issues. You'll be blessed with the job. Well, you're going to have to deal with people. Every promise that God has for you comes with problems. So oftentimes God uses the problems on the way to the promise to prepare you to handle the problems that comes when you get the promise, so that way you can enjoy the promise. Does that make sense? Because whenever you get what you want, you will often get what you don't want. No promotion without pressure. No growth without groanings. No healthy culture without confrontation. And sometimes if you get what you feel you are ready for before you are actually ready for it, the blessing will feel like a curse. Sometimes what feels like a blocking, a hindrance from God, may actually be a protection from God, because he's preparing you so that you will not be destroyed by what is to come. So if you do not have character and emotional maturity, the blessings will feel like a curse. So what am I saying? I'm saying do not reject the preparation of God. Listen to me carefully and remember this statement, especially for those of you who are young adults. Remember this, that God will let you live on whatever level you settle for. God will let you live on whatever level you settle for. I mean, this is true for all of us. God has amazing things for us, but if we choose to live on a level other than what God has designed for us, he let us live there. God has promised and God has prophesied Canaan to you. He may even have sent Moses to bring you out. But if you decide, I actually like Egypt, I have found a way to live in Egypt, I have found friends in Egypt. If you decide that you're going to stay in the wilderness, if you decide, I've gotten accustomed to the hot sun, I've gotten accustomed to little food, no food, sometimes food. If you decide you've gotten accustomed to the wilderness, then guess what? The wilderness is good enough for God. In other words, God will let you live on whatever level you settle for. So I'm saying to you, where you are may not be where God wants you to be, but you're there because you're choosing to stay there. Don't settle for the wilderness. Choose to step into everything that God has for you. But if you're going to go for everything that God has for you, you're going to have to learn to do life with a hammer in one hand and a weapon in the other. What am I saying? If you're going to go for everything that God has for you, you're going to have to learn to do life building and protecting, building and defending. That's how Christians live. You say, but Pastor, what does this again have to do with praise and worship? Well, I'm here. Because you have to learn to do life working and praising, living and praising. Let's look at a passage in Judges chapter 1. If you ask any person who has a military mind, there are two books in the Bible that they're going to love the most, and one is Judges and the second one is Ephesians. The book of Judges tells you how to fight, and Ephesians tells you how to possess according to the new covenant. And so Judges chapter 1:1-2. After the death of Joshua, the Israelites asked the Lord, who of us is to go up first to fight the Canaanites? You see, you were wondering, what's the connection to praise and worship? Remember, I was talking to you about fighting? I was getting somewhere. After the death of Joshua, he says, who of us? They said, who of us is going to go up first to fight the Canaanites? The Lord answered, Judah shall go up. Judah shall go up. I have given the land into their hands. Now notice, Joshua is dead. So now they can't go to him. I'm saying to you that sometimes God allows situations to happen so that you have no other choice but to go to him and him alone. God will take some things. He will cause some things to cease, to die out. He will cause some things to happen in your life so that you would become dependent on him and not the wrong thing. Because God is always about developing intimacy with us. And they said, who shall go up first? And notice what he responds. Judah shall go up first. Pastor, what's the connection to a worship and praise night? The word Judah means praise. They were about to step into what is theirs. And God's, and they said, well, who is going to go first? Who is going to lead in this fight? And the Lord says, praise shall get you. Am I making sense? Praise shall get you there. Notice, he did not. Now, we have a mindset, I will praise God after I'm in Canaan. I will praise God when I get it. But in this context, he says, praise does not come after the battle. He said, send praises before the battle. What am I saying? Beloved, I'm saying, I believe with all my heart that 95% of the people, whether tonight or later on, that will watch this, that will take in the service, you are facing some kind of battle. You are in the middle of a battle. You're about to go into a battle. You are the beginning of a battle. And here's what I'm saying to you. God is saying, send up praises. Exercise. Use your weapon of praise. Use your weapon of worship. Use your weapon of thanksgiving. So that's why tonight we don't want you to be entertained. This is not time to sit and entertain and say, oh, she missed the note, or he. No. This is the time for you to join in. And we're just trying to help you to exercise, to use your weapon of praise so that you can get through the battle, so that you can get out of your battle. Here's what has happened to us. And this is significant. Because what happens, because of habit, because of familiarity, our brain sometimes become hardened and develops default patterns. And so we begin to habitually think negatively. And so when we habitually think negatively, our brains become hardwired towards negative thinking. So we keep on facing challenges in life and difficulties in life. And then because our brains have become so hardwired, the neurological term I think gets in there is neuroplasticity or neurogenesis. What happens is we default all the time to negative stuff. So whenever something negative happens, you default to negative thinking. So when life gets tough, when things get difficult, you don't default to, God's going to get me out of this. My God is bigger than this. My God is capable. You begin to think, where is God? How am I going to do this? This will never change. That's why Paul said something. As a matter of fact, Paul was essentially saying in Philippians chapter 4, Paul was essentially saying, be mindful. Break that down. Be mindful. Paul was saying, let your mind be full of things that are lovely, things that are pure, things that are true, things that are right, things that are admirable. Let that be what fills your mind, because your peace is connected to what you choose to think on. When we engage in praise and worship, what happens? Our minds become full of the power of God. Our minds become full of what we sing about. And that's why these times of worship is absolutely important. He says, when you do that, the peace of God that passes all understanding will rule your heart and your mind. Why? Because your mind is now full of the right stuff. You see, you have to realize that your mind is like a field, a piece of land, and your life is the harvest. The harvest, in other words, your life will reflect what you fill your mind with, what you sow in the field. That's what your life will look like. And so if your life is not filled with the goodness of God, it means because you're not filling your mind with thoughts of the goodness of God. And so when we engage in times of praise and worship and thanksgiving, it helps us to get our minds full on the right stuff. Because praise causes you to think on how big your God is, not on how major your problems are. Praise focuses our thoughts on the goodness of God more than the negativity and the hardships of life. Praise causes change in you. Why? Because praise brings out the lion in us. Because when the praises go up, then the lion of the tribe of Judah comes out and fights for us. I said it last Sunday, it's time to change your attitude, your position, and your posture. Listen, one of the greatest ways to do that is to engage in praise and worship. It's very practical. Because all of a sudden, if you begin to praise, if you begin to engage in praise, your shoulders begin to square up. All of a sudden, when you begin to engage, he's a miracle working God. When you begin to engage in praise, all of a sudden your disposition changes. When you begin to engage in praise, listen, you do it for a minute or 2 minutes. As you begin to do it, your mood changes. As a matter of fact, as you engage in praise and worship, even your position, you may be sitting, you may be lying, but as you are genuinely engaging, your position changes because your toes start moving. Then all of a sudden your legs start moving, and then your hands start moving, because when you engage in praise, when Judah goes up, the lion comes out and he roars. And so the Bible tells us in Judges chapter 1, verses 4 to 6, when Judah attacked, I'm saying to you tonight, let your praise be your attack weapon. I don't know what you're facing, but I'm saying you don't have to fight it. Just praise the Lord, and that will attack it. When Judah attacked, the Bible says the Lord gave the Canaanites and Perizzites into their hands, and they struck down 10,000 men at Bezek. It was there that they found Adonai Bezek and fought against him, putting rout to the Canaanites and Perizzites. And Adonai Bezek fled. But here's what the Bible says. They chased him and caught him. And some of you might find this gross, but I love military stuff. And here's what they said. They caught him. They chased him and caught him. And they cut off his thumbs and his big toes. Let's stand, guys. They cut off his thumb. I mean that's kind of weird, kind of gross, kind of, you know, if you yeah, it may not be appropriate. You may have some issues with this. But here's what happens. Here's what happens. The power of praise will bring your enemies under your control. I'm just trying to encourage you to engage sincerely tonight, because the power of praise will bring your enemies under your control. They cut off his thumbs and his big toes. Well, listen, with no thumb, he could not grip the sword. I don't know about you, but my Jesus went down into the grave and he destroyed the power of death. Amen. Amen. The grave has no power over us anymore.
That's right.
We are no longer in the grips of sin. When they, with their thumbs cut off, they could not grip the sword to fight. I hope you get in the picture I'm trying to paint. The Bible says that they cut off the big toe. With the big toe cut off, they could not brace themselves to fight. In other words, they could not be on the offensive or the defensive. All they had to do was run. It's the power of praise. By the way, it's a good place to tell you, when you don't cut off in one season, if you don't cut some things off in one season, in another season, even in a new season, what you did not cut off will come back, and it will cause a new season to look like an old season, because you keep fighting the same battles because you didn't cut some things off. You see what happens is, you may think it's down, but it's not dead. That's why when David killed Goliath, he went up and cut his head off. Because sometimes what you think is dead is just broken. So tonight I want us to engage in praise, in worship, in thanksgiving. The battle is not ours. It's the Lord's. And at the end of the day, we are facing stuff, but we win. We win. Beloved, we have a promise, especially in this Easter season, that is true. We have a hope for this life. And it's amazing. God did not just give us hope for this life, but he gave us hope for the life to come. Listen, beloved, we are going to a city. We have a promise that no matter how hard life is now, we are going to a city. And in that city, roses never die. We are going to a city where the word goodbye has never been uttered. We are going to a city where tears have never been shed. We are going to a city where there is no sorrow, no sickness, no separation, no suffering there. We have a hope. We have a God that is real and that is capable. We are going to a city where we walk in streets of gold. We live in mansions built by the master architect. And here is the amazing thing. Here's what I want you to get. We have a hope for the life to come, and we have a hope for this life. He promised to never leave us. He promised to defend us. He promised to fight for us. He promised to protect us. He promised to deliver us. And beloved, let me tell you something. When we get to that city, but we don't have to wait until we get there. But when we get to that city, we will praise the one that we praise without seeing him tonight, but we will praise him there in person. So tonight is only a rehearsal for what we're going to do then. Because one day we'll see the Lion of the tribe of Judah in person. And when we do, we will lay our crowns at his feet, because he's our Lord. So tonight we are going to worship him because he's our Savior. We are going to worship him because he's our Redeemer. We are going to worship him and praise him because he's our healer. He's the burden bearer. He's the chain breaker. He's the way maker. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the great Ayahuasca. He's the great shepherd of the sheep. He's the great physician. He's the light of the world and the hope of glory. He's the good shepherd. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. There is none like him. Blessed be his holy name. Wonderful and powerful is his name. I dare you tonight to stand where you are and join us as we worship the King of kings and the Lord of lords.
You the name of Jesus.
All the saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God. Worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Storms and to thy calm. Out of distress to jubilant psalm, Jesus, I come to thee. Out of unrest and arrogant pride, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come, into thy blessed will to abide. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of myself to dwell in thy love, out of despair to rapture above. Upward I rise on wings like a dove. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of the fear and dread of the tomb, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come into the joy and light of thy home. Jesus, I come to thee. Out of the depths of ruin untold, into thy peaceful sheltering fold. Ever thy glorious face to behold, Jesus, I come to thee.
Psalm 102 is a prayer for those who are overwhelmed and for all the discouraged who come to pour out their hearts before the Lord. Verse 1 says, Lord, listen to my prayer. Listen to my cry for help, for my days of happiness have gone up in smoke. My body is raging with fever. My heart is sick and I'm confused by this illness. Withered like a dead leaf, I can't even eat. I'm depressed, lonely, forgotten, and abandoned. I'm sleepless, shivering in the cold, forlorn and friendless, like a lonely bird on a rooftop. But verse 12, but then I remember that you, O Lord, still sit enthroned as king over all. The fame of your name will be revealed to every generation. When you arise to intervene, all the nations and kings will be stunned and will fear your awesome name, trembling before your glory. This is the God who's a safe God for us to pour out our hearts. Whatever is troubling you, whatever is on your mind, pour it out to Him. For I know that you hear every cry. You are listening, no matter what state my heart is in. You are faithful to answer with words that are true and a hope that is real, as I feel your touch. You bring a freedom to all that's within. Here I am once again. I pour out my heart, for I know that you hear every cry. You are listening, no matter what state my heart is in. You are faithful to answer with words that are true and a hope that is real, as I feel your touch. You bring a freedom to all that's within, in the safety of
my heart to say that I love you. Pour out my heart to say that I need you. Pour out my heart to say that I'm thankful. Pour out my heart to say that you're wonderful.
Well, spirit on the broken. Give beauty for your ashes and joy for your sadness. Heaven open. I'm the river in the desert and pouring my spirit on the broken. Giving beauty for your ashes and joy for your sadness.
Yeah.
rapture praise, rapture praise and endless worship will be our sweet portion there. We give all the thanks to the Lord, thanks to the Lord, thanks to the Lord. We give all the thanks to the Lord, thanks to the Lord.
Hallelujah. Death could not hold him.
Amen.
He has no rival.
Yes.
He has no equal. Now and forever, he's God. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you guys who are here for being a part of this worship night. I trust that you are blessed. And if you have been blessed, would you go ahead and let us know in the chat. Just simply declare, I am blessed. Just type that out in there, I am blessed. As a matter of fact, let us know that you are blessed, but also declare to yourselves that you are blessed and let the enemy know that you are blessed. As a matter of fact, if you want to go further, just declare, I am blessed, highly favored, anointed, and set apart by God. Whatever you feel, go ahead and make that declaration in the chat. Tonight, I'm so happy that you have chosen to be with us, and we plan to do this once a month. We begin the month with the first week of prayer. On the first Monday, the leaders pray. On the first Wednesday, the congregation prays. And then the last Friday of the month, the last weekend, we want to dedicate it to a time of praise. And I was blessed by the exhortation tonight because I just feel there's power in praise. And I love the fact that once we send up Judah first, I mean, the battle is guaranteed.
Yes.
And I want to encourage you to continue to do that. Keep praise as a priority in your life. And remember that when you praise, God gives you power to cut the thumb and the big toe of the enemy in your life. In other words, you are getting rid of his grip. You are getting rid of his stronghold, his offensive and his defensive power in your life. So keep praise in your life. Let praise be a priority. And so thank you again. And so, beloved, as we bring our service to a close, I remind you that we're going to do this again Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, for our Lord's Day service. But until then, friends, may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the full comfort and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, let it rest, remain, and abide with us all, both now and forever. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you with a wonderful night. As a matter of fact, it's nighttime. Let's put on the screen real quick, and afterwards we'll sing Victory in Jesus. Let's put our night prayer together. Wherever you are, let's pray this nighttime prayer together. Father,
we thank you for the blessings of the day that is past.
And we ask for your protection through the coming night. Give us good and restorative sleep and bring us safely to the morning hours. With a sincere desire to love you and serve you and live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Victory in Jesus.
I heard an old story, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood.
Oh.
He loved me ere I knew him,
and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory.
Oh, victory
in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood.
Mm-hmm.